Sorry for the quickness of the lunch break, but we really want to make time to, in this second session, get into more of a meaty discussion about what does it actually mean concretely? How do we build the socialist movement in the age of Trump? And we're very lucky to have with us here today Bhaskar Sankara, the founding editor and publisher of Jacobin Magazine and a vice chair of the Democratic Socialists of America. And also Philip Locker, the National Secretary of Socialist Alternative. So we're gonna let each of them speak for a little while to kind of lay out their ideas of what it means to build the socialist movement under Trump, and then we'll have some time for discussion and questions in the middle before they wrap up again at the end. So with no further ado, Philip, would you like to kick us off?
Is it on now? Yes. Well, thank you. And thank you all so much for being here. It's a very exciting event to see so many people, so many fresh faces. And you know, I think it's a sign of the times of the growing interest and opportunity for building the socialist movement, the coming, you know, the advance wave of a coming, hopefully, tidal wave of socialist forces. So it's very, it's quite exciting the whole day. But I think, you know, obviously we do not have enough people in this room, do we? And building a socialist movement that's actually serious about socialism, which I think is what we aim to do, that's actually serious about overthrowing capitalism, that means we actually have to really grapple with and look at what is it going to take to build a much bigger and much stronger movement. Obviously we've made some real steps forward in the past period. There's been a growth of socialist forces in the US, but it's still a drop in the bucket. In a society of 330 million people in the most powerful capitalist country in the world. So it's not, we have to have a serious strategy and serious thought and a clear set of politics to actually be able to make a real difference in the course of US history. So I'm gonna lay out a few different points from the perspective of socialist alternative. I'm sure there's a lot of things that we'll agree on, maybe some things that we'll have a good discussion and debate about. And I think a lot of the points were already made in the first session, but I'm going to just try to bring things together a little bit here and add a few things. I think the defining question, which was reflected in the first session, for if we're talking about building the socialist movement, has to be linked with the reality that we face here in the US today, and that the burning question that all political trends are going to have to address is what is the most effective strategy to fight Trump. And it's within that context that the socialist movement will either prove itself as an effective force, as something really to contribute, or not. And that's the key, I think, litmus test, not just a set of nice ideas, but can it actually make a living, vibrant contribution to building this movement that is everyone can feel is necessary. And I think that also has to be located in the fact that there is a broad, there's an enormous sea of resistance against Donald Trump. We can thank him for that, that we have an unprecedented mass mobilization and politicization of US society. He's acted, in one sense, as a great unifier, bringing together all the various strands of discontent and protest movements that were divided into against one common hated target in the form of a quite despicable individual, Donald Trump. But we also need to recognize within that there's many different political trends that reflect a wide variety of political approaches and that actually at base represent different social interests that we're united against Trump, but we're not. There's a lot of divisions within the anti-Trump movement. And I think socialists have an important, have a critical, vital, essential contribution in that discussion, where we have to accept, as was made before, the idea that we need unity in action. We can't let those differences get in the way of having a unity amongst all those who are prepared to fight against Trump, but also having an open and vigorous debate within our movement about the different ideas and different strategies and program to fight Trump and actually eventually bring him down, which I think has to be our aim. And I would just want to list off, I think, five key elements that I think socialists have a unique contribution And not only socialists, other forces on the left will also bring these forward, but I think socialists have the clearest, most conscious understanding of and can help prepare and equip our movement to be clear about. And one, I think, most elementary, but actually a critical starting point, and it's the sharpest contrast between the left and the liberal establishment, which does oppose Trump for their own reasons, is that we base ourselves on resistance, not collaboration. And we saw that very starkly shown after the election with liberal spokespeople like Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama saying that Trump deserves our support. We need to give him a chance. We want to work with him. That, we need to say, is a fundamentally deadly strategy, right? And the starting point for the left in the anti-Trump movement has to be waging a relentless ideological struggle against that idea of collaboration, that we need a bold resistance in all the different arenas against Donald Trump and the billionaire class that he represents. I think a second critical point, which again, it's not just socialists, but I think also socialists are very clear about this, it came up in the first session, is building a mass movement, that we can't wait for we do not have the luxury of waiting for the 2018 elections or the 2020 elections to try to remove Donald Trump or the Republicans. Our focus needs to be now on building a mass movement in the streets that can block his agenda, like we've seen with the Muslim ban and with Trump care, but also with the aim of eventually bringing him down. It's possible we don't even have to wait till 2018 or 2020 to drive this monster from office. And that's linked to a vision of building a mass collective struggle, which is part of our overriding task as socialists, is building the power of the 99%, working people and all those marginalized by the capitalist elite. And that's the burning litmus test for socialists in all strategic and tactical questions, is do they help enlarge our movement with more people engaging in collective action? Do they raise the level of organization, consciousness, and confidence of our side to fight back? Or do they isolate and weaken us? I think a third thing is the question of what kind of tactics do we deploy? The need for determined fighting tactics. That includes, and a critical starting point, is mass protests like we saw on January 21st, the women's marches. But also we need to go beyond just routine protests that are symbolic. And we need to find ways to disrupt the normal functioning of the economy and threaten the profits of big business. And a number of speakers spoke about that earlier, about the importance of May 1st as beginning to stretch our muscles in that direction. Obviously, we saw elements of that on March 8th on International Women's Day. We saw that the airport occupations were a prime example of that, but we need to be promoting and not just letting that happen unconsciously, but we need a lead in the anti-Trump movement of advocating the idea of student walkouts, blockades, sit-down protests to block deportations and immigrant detention facilities. But also our most important power is to harness the social power of workers to shut down production, distribution, and services through workplace actions, including strikes. A fourth element is what kind of program we put forward, what kind of demands. To inspire, if our strategic aim is to build mass movements that can truly shake US society, that requires numbers. It requires millions and tens of millions to take action. What kind of program will inspire people to take that kind of action? And for that, I think obviously our starting point has to be defense. We also want to block and defend against all the litany of attacks from Trump and the Republicans, be they on immigrants, on LGBTQ people, on healthcare, et cetera, on public education. But we cannot, like the liberal establishment of the Democratic Party, restrict ourselves just to a purely defensive program. To mobilize the tens of millions that are necessary, we also have to articulate demands and policies that would represent, if they're fulfilled, a dramatic improvement in the living conditions of ordinary working people here in the United States. So we've seen that play out very clearly on the debate on health care. The most effective opponents of Trump care, the most effective, obviously, the left should not be ultra left. We should oppose the Republican attempt to repeal Obamacare. But we oppose that with from a critical standpoint, not with dressing it up, not with illusions, not like pretending and telling people lies that Obamacare is wonderful and it's with a status quo is great. As Hillary Clinton said, America's already great. We're far more effective in fighting the repeal of Obamacare if we link that to a vision of extending it, of going forward to Medicare for all. And we've seen that play out concretely with the most effective advocate has been Bernie Sanders in taking the case to defend Obamacare and extend it to Medicare for all, taking that into Trump country as opposed to people like Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer and Hillary Clinton who have utter failures at winning a majority of working people in this country. Finally, we need a strategic orientation, not so much at this stage, unfortunately, socialists who are not leading this movement, who are not a dominant force in the anti-Trump movement, but the anti-Trump movement as a whole, the mass movement needs to have an orientation to splitting Donald Trump's base, to winning away a section of workers who mistakenly were fooled into voting for Donald Trump in the last election. Some of them are unwinnable. Some of them are hardened reactionaries who we're not going to win over. But there are millions of working people who were fooled into voting for Donald Trump who can be won to a clear program, a class appeal against the billionaire class. And we've seen that again with Bernie Sanders' appeal going into Trump country with his town halls, calling for Medicare for all, calling for a $15 hour minimum wage, talking about having a major over $1 trillion investment in infrastructure to create jobs, 15 million jobs. And demands like that, not on the basis of downplaying, not on the basis of trying to have agreement on the lowest common denominator, of ignoring the racism and sexism and xenophobia that Trump is whipping up. We should absolutely, that needs to be combated and fought against. But also trying to reach out and appeal to those layers and isolate the most right-wing elements behind Trump. And I think that will also require a political debate within our movement against, on the one hand, the liberal establishment, which if they are allowed to lead the anti-Trump movement, will be deadly, will be poisonous, will make it much, much harder to win over that section of Trump voters who could be won over, and we saw that in the last election. Hillary Clinton was incapable of doing that. But also within our movement, some leftist trends, particularly those informed by a trend within of privilege theory, who also write off white working class people who voted for Trump and see them as lost forever, as reactionaries who are benefiting from the racism and sexism in our society. And I think that requires a political and ideological debate within our movement that Marxists and socialists are most equipped to answer. So, coming out of all of that, I just want to wrap up on the anti-Trump movement and then a few proposals of how socialists can make further breakthroughs going forward on the political plane. But wrapping up on the anti-Trump movement, I think we have to be conscious as socialists and be organized that the anti-Trump movement is not some happy-go-lucky family where we're all united. We do unite tonight against Trump. We don't want to have unnecessary divisions. But we also need a rigorous debate and discussion in that movement. And we need to recognize there's big elements in the anti-Trump movement who will lead us down a path of defeat. That we need to build a strong left wing of the anti-Trump movement. And that has to have a socialist backbone of it that's clear on these issues. And it's not just based on a loose, vague sentiment, but it has to be organized and conscious to fight for leadership of the anti-Trump movement to make sure that we're not led by the Hillary Clintons and fellow friends who will lead this movement into make it a much longer, more painful path to defeating Donald Trump. And that requires socialists have clear proposals, clear policies that they systematically campaign for and argue for and build conscious and organized support within our movement and not allow, let's be clear, the liberal forces are quite organized. They have a quite clear network through the mass media, through the foundations, through academia, through the leadership of different social movement organizations, and they will push very hard for their interests and their agenda and we have to be just as organized. Now, finally, I just wanted to also address, I think that's a big part of building the socialist movement, unfortunately, in the next period, is that battle within the anti-Trump movement of millions of people looking to take action, moving to struggle, and there'll be a real thirst for ideas and strategy and policies for what will be most effective. And socialists need to be there. They need to have a clear profile, be present, and be confident putting forward our politics and building a base of support within that movement. The other side of it, also, is I think we have a big opening on the electoral plane and on the political plane. And that's not for a narrow-minded view that the way to change society is in elections or politics as most people see them in elections, but as a tool to organize, as a tool to build support and build understanding and build our forces. And there's the background to that is we have an unprecedented for many decades, interest in socialist ideas in the U.S. right now. More millennials support socialism than capitalism. That is a sea change. That is a major change in U.S. society. We've seen a tremendous growth of Democratic Socialist America, now to, I believe, over 20,000 members, which is to only be welcomed as a fantastic development of thousands of people wanting to get organized and get active and build the socialist movement. But I think we'd agree the interest in socialism goes beyond that. There's a big audience that is drawing socialist conclusions, that wants to build the socialist movement. How do we reach them? How do we get that from a vague sentiment into a more distinct, organized, concrete form? And I think one of the best tools we have is running independent socialist candidates for office. We've done that, we've shown that here in Seattle, how socialists can actually speak to a broad audience, really popularize socialist ideas and make socialist politics concrete and visible and real by standing candidates. Not with illusions that by electing we're going to overthrow capitalism, but using it as a platform to organize and build support. And we've done that with Shama Sawant, and now we've seen after years of agitating and hammering away on the idea that the Democratic Party is a dead end for building, for if you want radical change, we now are seeing more candidates follow that path that we've helped prepare of running independent of the Democratic Party, refusing corporate money, running as independent left candidates. We saw that earlier today with Nikita Oliver and John Grant running for two out of the three main city elections this year. And whether they win or lose, we can be confident they're going to run credible, vibrant campaigns that will help put key issues on the table, push the establishment to the left, and build support for a social justice activist agenda. Can we do that more nationally? Can groups like Socialist Alternative, but also DSA, which is now has over 20,000 members, come together and other forces on the left, like the ISO, and identify, let's be modest, can we find 10 candidates throughout the United States where we can run vigorous, viable, credible campaigns as independent socialists, independent of the Democratic Party and Republican Party, if there's any confusion about that, but openly as socialists in local elections this year as a way, again, to organize and tap into the growing interest in socialist ideas and building the socialist movement, pushing the Democratic Party to the left, et cetera. In our view, in Socialist Alternative, that would be a step towards building a new socialist party in this country, a broad socialist party, that the interest is there now. And we think for a party of 50, 100,000 people as a socialist party in the next period to be built in the United States. That will not happen automatically, though. It does require seizing that opportunity and building it. And we want to work together with forces like the Democratic Socialist America, which obviously now are the driving engine of that process and can take the lead in at a certain stage launching a broader socialist party that will be open to different trends, including, Socialist Alternative, the ISO, other forces on the left, but most importantly, that would reach out and bring together the tens of thousands of new people who are not yet organized, who want to get involved in the socialist movement. And I think a broad socialist party like that would be important, that there be the right for political tendencies and groupings. We're not going to agree about everything, that we can come together and unite in a broad party as socialists, but a freedom to debate, discuss different forces, to put forward their ideas in an organized way, but also have an orientation to the much bigger audience the millions of workers, the progressive workers in the U.S. who still haven't yet drawn socialist conclusions, who are looking to Bernie Sanders and the left-wing Democrats to try to push the Democrats or transform the Democratic Party into a so-called People's Party, and have a dialogue, a friendly dialogue with those forces over the next few years. In our view, and just to wrap up on this, the Democratic Party will fight tooth and nail against those efforts. They will be blocked. They will not allow the left to take over their party and their institution without an almighty struggle. And we saw a taste of that in the Bernie Sanders campaign last year. If the left was to succeed in seriously transforming the Democratic Party and making it independent of corporate influence, not taking any corporate money, of a grassroots party that has a mass membership, that has democratic control of the party, that has a clear anti-corporate left platform, we should not think there's anything good in that party unless they can achieve those things. If they achieve those things, 90% of all elected Democrats in this country would flee. They would split from that party. And in essence, you would see a new party formed if they actually were able to carry out that program. Nancy Pelosi, Chuck Schumer will never accept that agenda. And if the left was to win a majority in the Democratic Party, they would rather split than be part of that. So no matter what, there's going to be a new party need to be built in this country in the next period. It'll either be built outside the Democratic Party or maybe, which I think is far more likely, through a split. But either way, a socialist force can have a dialogue, can act as a catalyst to speed that up and be part of that. And that's what I think has to be the medium-term vision that at least Socialist Alternative is looking towards, to try to push that forward, that process forward as fast as possible, while also openly and energetically trying to build the socialist forces as part of that process that have a clearer vision of where we're going and can and prepare our movements to for the battles that are coming.
Thank you, Philip. I actually agree with quite a lot of what Philip said, so I'll just kind of give my broad overview of the situation and also maybe push back on just a couple of Philip's points, and those won't really be deep disagreements so much as points of emphasis, what I have is a different time horizon, a different sense of what's possible necessarily in the short term. I would say that overall there is some good news, and the good news is that Trump doesn't have a mandate. The bad news is that there's still a chance he could develop one. So I think what we've seen in the Trump administration is kind of a lesson in Marxist state theory, kind of. So you see basically this, that capitalists are using a series of carrots and sticks with the Trump administration. So if you want to know what Trump proposal or one thing that's leaked or proposed will be pushed through and made into law and what won't, you should just think about, not to put it so crassly, but what's in the interest of dominant business interests in this country. So in other words, it's not that all of a sudden the U.S. capitalist class has become a lot more racist and xenophobic in particular than they used to be. In fact, I think there hasn't been much of a shift at that ideological level in the U.S. capitalist class. What happened is that now there's an agent administering the state that happens to have these views. So when it comes to, let's say, the Trump administration talking about adding a 20% tax on imports coming in from Mexico, that's something that is not acceptable to a lot of capitalists who have already kind of set up their production process in such a way, and they have the value chain set up in such a way that, you know, this would be completely disastrous to enough capitalists and be a bad enough precedent that I don't think we'll see that happen. Now, when it comes to something like the refugee ban, now, even if a lot of individual capitalists might disagree with the ban on certain humanist, ethical considerations and whatnot, are they actually willing to put up a fight against administration for something that is of no material consequence or interest to their businesses or the corporations? So, no. So, in other words, I think you'll see certain Trump measures that are quite reactionary and vile be pushed through, other reactionary measures being stopped, but the bottom line is kind of what's in the interest of this capitalist class. So there is some autonomy here in the Trump administration. He's not directly getting his orders from elites, but they're trying to work with the administration. They're trying to encourage some behavior, like some of the pro-Wall Street policies, but discourage some of the other kind of more protectionist planks of Trump's proposal. And even there, there's divides in the capitalist class between those that would benefit from some of these protections and those who, the dominant interests that would not. Now, then the Trump administration has this extra problem. How do you now reconcile this very delicate balance they're trying to have between their agenda and the agenda of the dominant business interests in this country? Then on the other hand, how do you now deal with have a base that has high expectations, or at least expectations for things to get done? You know, Trump throughout the campaign, yes, he portrayed himself as a racist, a sexist, a xenophobe, and all that, but he also portrayed himself as someone who would roll up his sleeves and get things done. So I think a lot of his supporters just, you know, want to see the government in action in some form. They want to see some sort of vaguely both redistributive and exclusionary measures, and they're not getting what they asked for. If you look at the Trump Care disaster, if you look at actual infrastructure bill pushed through by the Trump administration, these are things very much at odds with his rhetoric. Now, again, I don't think Trump's necessarily lying about this. I was going to say, I don't think Trump's a liar. Of course, he's a liar. But on this issue, I think it's mostly a problem of his agenda being influenced and shaped, then him having to negotiate this already compromised agenda with Paul Ryan and the business Republicans and whatnot. So all this is to say that the Trump administration has a degree of credibility still among its base, but even that, to begin with, was a minoritarian mandate. Trump was a third choice of voters. He was a choice behind people not voting at all, which is what most American workers do, not out of apathy, but out of, you know, the common sense that voting for the last, you know, four or five times hasn't changed much. Maybe I'll, you know, sit this one out, especially if I don't even get the day off, or voting for Hillary Clinton. Now, the problem is we could actually imagine a scenario where a populist government is able to build a mass base and is able to, even the Trump administration now, build a deep mandate. So, for example, what if Trump actually pursued a very aggressive infrastructure plan that actually involved the kind of deficit financing that Steve Bannon and the smarter people in his administration wanted? And what if he reconciled this with the interests of the Republican Congress by saying that a lot of this work would be done through public-private partnerships? It's not outside the realm of possibility. It could still mean an immediate stimulus to the economy and an immediate drop in unemployment and all these other things that would cement more of a social base. And especially because Trump's agenda has primarily been one that's been, of course, racist, like every Republican administration for the past, you know, decades and decades, but has been primarily xenophobic, you could actually imagine Trump maybe, through these programs, winning over a base of, say, the black working class community from getting around 10% of the vote to getting 20, 25, which doesn't sound like a lot. It isn't a lot, but it would be enough to cement what was essentially a fluke electoral victory into something more concrete. So unless we actually, you know, see these possibilities and see these trends, and I think we might fall into the trap of complacency and basically just saying this is a bungling administration with no support, and he's offending so many groups in the country that demographically it just is hard to contemplate how he survives and wins in 2020, I think, again, we might be falling into the trap of underestimating Trump. And I was on camera plenty of times last year saying there is no chance of Trump getting elected. So I'm have a bit more pause now. Now, essentially, though, what we have is we have kind of a divide between a discredited and disliked center that doesn't seem to be able to offer any sort of moral and ethical vision for people. Like Philip said, Trump said, make America great again. Hillary Clinton said, America's already great. And Hillary Clinton's other main appeal was, I've been in politics for 30 years. So if the past 30 years have seemed pretty miserable for you, and if you don't like politicians, and you don't think America's already great, I mean, I'm just saying, it's not the best appeal. I think a socialist response would be just to kind of split the difference and say, we're going to make America great, you know, full stop. We won't answer any questions about where the supposed greatness was before. But then we also have this dangerous right, and when I say right, in this discussion, I'm talking more about the populist right. There are also fringe elements in the far right that are becoming emboldened. I think these elements are already dangerous now, but they're going to become far more dangerous when we actually politically defeat the populist right, if we do. And a segment of this kind of defeated base is radicalized again. And then we have a somewhat emerging left, and I think we should qualify kind of the extent to this emergence and its strength. So, you know, when I look at the situation in the country, I kind of just, at least, you know, I pinch myself because I'm like, Donald Trump is president, which, again, I didn't anticipate, but also thank God for Bernie Sanders. Now, you know, I say this because can you imagine a scenario where you had just the Hillary Clinton Center represented in American politics, and then you had this new kind of like bumbling populist right, and you had nothing else on offer? And everyone on the left who opposed the kind of xenophobic right was then told, well, you should kind of band together with this, like, you know, liberal, multicultural center because it's the only alternative. I think that would be a nightmare scenario. And Bernie Sanders at least demonstrated that there is, in fact, not a notional one, but an immediate potential for a social majority in this country around social democratic values. We shouldn't overstate what his campaign demonstrated, but at least it demonstrated that. It demonstrated that a narrative that tells to people that, you know, you work hard and you're getting screwed, and we know the people responsible for you not having enough of the things you deserve. And it's not minorities, it's not immigrants, it's the millionaires and billionaires, like Bernie said. That message we saw does have popular resonance. And to a certain extent, if our goal was to make that message a majority, I think we have a better starting point now than if we were kind of the Steve Bannons of the world trying to craft a majority around an ethno-nationalist politics. Doesn't mean that we'll win and they'll lose, but it does mean that as a starting point, I think to win an electoral majority, we already have that potential, that head start. It's obviously more difficult to actually legislate social democratic reforms. I think we're very, very far away from the social base to do that. But as far as winning people over to the broad idea, I think we're close to being there. I don't want to echo verbatim what Philip said, because I agree with what he said completely when it relates to the question of this kind of idea that we all need to unite. Everyone who's not Donald Trump, in other words, in this narrative, you know, should be fighting Donald Trump. And I think Philip, got into a lot of the pitfalls with this approach. I mean, you see, like, liberals literally holding up George W. Bush as, like, a model, as, like, the good one. You know, it almost reminds me of, like, you know, I don't know, is he like an Erwin Rommel or something? Is he like, you know, yeah, he wasn't so bad. He wasn't so bad. Like my favorite History Channel documentaries growing up were the World War II ones, and the History Channel really loved Rommel. I was like 8, and all I knew from my parents were, of course, Indian and Trinidadian. The British are bad, so I was like, oh, is this the good guy? I was in for a rude awakening when I actually read a book a year later. So then the question is basically, I put this kind of to say that in a certain way, our primary enemy, I shouldn't use the word primary, but one of our main enemies and focuses of attack needs to be this neoliberal center. One, because this neoliberal center is weak at the moment. It's been discredited, and a lot of the people who are its natural voters are actually looking for alternatives, and we need to provide alternatives. Now, when I say this, it isn't to say this is kind of a third period, you know, social democracy or something that I'm proposing. What I'm saying is that we need to actually make sure that this leadership and establishment class Democratic Party is separated as much as possible from the base. So we don't tell people who voted for Hillary Clinton, you know, you were wrong, you helped cause Trump, blah, blah, blah. But we do say that, you know, the inadequate answers of Hillary Clinton, this mode and style of politics, this platform, this kind of mix of basic neoliberal politics mixed in with the rhetoric of social inclusion completely failed. And instead we want to, pose a different alternative. I feel like you guys have just monopolized excessively two words I happen to use a lot. Like, I was like, you know.
Free to take them.
When I say, you know, we need a socialist alternative, by the way, I'm not causing, you know, I don't want to throw Philip into like existential crisis or something. I just want, you know, I mean lowercase s, lowercase a, I know you exist.
As long as you direct people to socialistalternative.org, I'm happy.
No, I lost my train of thought. I'm not sure if there was one there to begin with, but essentially it is to say that we need to be telling these people that, in fact, if you share these values and concerns that would lead someone to oppose Donald Trump, including in the ballot box, then you should be looking at our politics and our ideas. That's it. Now, we need to combine, in other words, a very hard, aggressive stance against the Democratic establishment with the willingness to work with other people. And I often think about the example of, you know, the communists in the 1930s and other groups on the left in American history that have actually managed to establish something close to mass base. When we could disagree with their actual politics or what they did with this mass base, but they were embedded deeply in American society. And the way their politics is often described is hard in the center and soft on the edges. So in other words, they were rigorously trained, they were Marxists, they knew kind of what they stood for, what they wanted and whatnot. But they were always willing to work within broader organizations. They were always willing to work within broader fronts. And often they did do this in, as you know, often a kind of what Irving Howe used to call a brilliant masquerade, right? Just kind of, you know, in the most opportunistic and short-term kind of ways. But they did develop a base. Now I think increasingly, and the danger with some aspects of the kind of new young left emboldened by Bernie Sanders, is that many of us are kind of soft at the core, I still have like fairly undefined politics, which is, again, is perfectly natural and fine for someone first getting engaged with politics, but also have that combined with kind of unremitting hostility to people not immediately where we're at. So, you know, I like to say that I would assume that I'm probably much nicer to Hillary Clinton supporters than people like maybe a step and a half to my right, but that's not, you know, me kind of slowly drifting towards the right, though, you know, I am pretty broke, so if anyone has any job offers, I'll listen. You know, it is, I think, in this spirit, and I think that's very important, but fundamentally, I think we need to conceive of this as a sword and shield situation where we're guarding against Trump, but we recognize that unless we dislodge the center, and unless we become the main opposition to Trump, then this cycle is going to continue over and over again. And we can look at the situation in France, where you have the only major visible anti-establishment force at the national level is now the populist right. And this is a country with probably a worse than populist right, an almost quasi-fascist right. And this is a country which, of course, a very deep tradition on the left. And this happened because of a politics of kind of short-term looking for like anyone who could defeat the very worst person in the room without articulating kind of our own independent politics. And I think this is a real danger in the age of Trump when any opposition, if you even mention Hillary Clinton or Barack Obama or anyone else's name today, it's often seen as you're doing a disservice to the fight against Trump. I think we need to make the argument clearly that, in fact, we're doing the opposite. We're laying the groundwork for a politics that can not only defeat Trump, but Trumpism. Now, I'll conclude by talking briefly about the situation on the socialist left. Obviously, you know, I think things are going relatively well on the socialist left. I like to say that it's probably the, you know, best time to be a socialist since the 1970s. The bad news is that it's also not a very good time to be a socialist in the U.S. just because, you know, it never really is. DSA, when I joined it, had maybe 5,000 members or so. I joined about 10 years ago. The first meeting I went to in New York City had about 4 or 5 people at it. It was a pretty depressing experience. It took me about a year to get my next one. Now today, obviously, DSA has 20,000 members. This, though, I think we should be happy about this, but we should also recognize the extent to which it's kind of a media event, right? So this is people joining DSAs in ones and twos as a result of a ballooned and inflated profile in kind of liberal media outlets. It's a result of just, you know, people being recruited in ones and twos on the internet. That's not to say it's a bad thing. It's just to say this is our starting base, and we should acknowledge how we kind of got to this point. What it means is that it only kind of reinforces what's become a divide on the left in almost three parts, right? And even the way people discuss it without even thinking about it. People talk about the socialist left, then they talk about social movements, then they talk about the working class. This is obviously a sign of an atomized left without much of an organic social base. It doesn't mean that many of us didn't come from working class, you know, backgrounds. It does mean that, you know, I came from a working class, you know, family, an immigrant family. But the reason why I kind of found the left and became a socialist because I had plenty of time to read and I was on a university track. So, you know, I kind of discovered it when I was on my way out of the working class. I think many people either do that or nowadays, I would imagine sociologically, a lot of these new recruits to socialist left are kind of on their way down from the professional middle class when they kind of graduate from college with lots of debt and little job opportunities and whatnot. So all this is to say we need some sort of politics of implantation. So instead of having these three separate silos, we're in fact building a working class movement that's actively engaged in day-to-day struggles and produces socialist leaders. It's easier said than done, but I think some of what capital S, capital A, Socialist Alternative did in Seattle is a good step in that direction. Partially because they took a small group and a small group of people in Seattle, and they were able to do a campaign that not only built the profile of their organization, but built the profile of socialist politics, gave an excuse to actually talk to working people, knock on their doors, canvas, and do these other things. And I think it's a very important model for DSA and for others. There's a whole network also of worker centers, of immigrant rights centers, of existing organizations that are going on. But I think the key is to get our politics as far as away from just kind of the campus as possible and more deeply rooted in working class life. And it's easier said than done, but it does mean that we're not happy or content or say that we're growing the movement, because it's better to have, you know, 15, 20,000 people very well positioned than, you know, 50,000 people who are just meeting and just almost participating in the creation of a subculture instead of the start of working class organizing. I would also say there's certain dangers and pitfalls to that approach. Just like in social movements, there's the danger of NGOism and its ties to the Democratic Party. There's the danger of electoralism that comes from political races. But if you foreground your platform, if you foreground your ideology, and you're clear about what you're trying to do, you're trying to create an alternative politics over the course of 10, 20 years, and not just immediately trying to usher in kind of a set of policies, even though, of course, we you know, agree with the fight for day-to-day reforms and policies, I think we'd be in a better position. And I wrap up by saying that, you know, when I say we need to do this implantation, we need to combine it with a sense of political education. We need to take people who are coming into these organizations, we need to expose them to a vision of politics, socialist history, and all these other things. In a way, of course, it isn't doctrinaire, but in a way that gives people a grounding. It gives them a grounding to improvise, right? So I would conclude by saying that someone beforehand in front of one of the tables said that, you know, it's great that the left is, you know, less sectarian now. And they were commenting just on the fact that, you know, it was like an ISO table, Socialist Alternative table, DSA table, right there. And in general, lots of people on the left identify first and foremost as socialists, then with their respective organizations. Of course, I agree. I couldn't disagree with something like that. But there's a difference between new recruits of the left being non-sectarian just out of ignorance and non-sectarian out of choice. In other words, I think it's important that people actually talk about political debates and where they disagree with each other. They actually have arguments. They actually, you know, are able to have these things, but then still are able to have a unity in, you know, actually doing day-to-day action and actually working together on causes and whatnot. Then we'll find out which one of these kind of tactical and strategic divides are kind of fake or just intellectual. You know, what year the Russian Revolution went wrong? We talked about this last night. I said 1919 because I'm a reformist, but at least I didn't say 1917, you know. But and which of these are actually deeply rooted in kind of our day-to-day lives and you know, are things we have to resolve if we're going to work together. The final thing, yeah, I'll leave the rest for Q&A. I have some disagreements with Philip's time horizon, but as far as a broad sketch of what should happen, you know, we're on the same page, which I think is a good start.
All right, so now we are going to have some time for participation from all of you who are here today. We will spend about 15 minutes taking questions and comments, and then we will give a window of 5 or 10 minutes for Philip and Bhaskar to respond. And then we'll have another window of 15 or so minutes for questions and comments. And then Philip and Bhaskar will wrap us up again at the end and hopefully try to respond to some of those questions again in their sum up. So again, you can ask a question either to Philip or Bhaskar. You can ask a question to the room in general. You can make a comment on something you've heard today or something that you want to hear addressed in this discussion or something that someone else from the audience has said. We're asking that you try to keep your questions and comments to 2 minutes. There's a lot of people in the room. Not everyone who wants to speak is going to get a chance to speak. We apologize for that, but that's just the way it is. But if you can keep your comments to 2 minutes, that will help more people have a chance to participate. Up here in this front corner, Dan is going to be holding up a sign to show when you've been speaking for 1 minute. And then if you get to the 2 minute mark, a wrap up sign. So please try and respect that sign. If you go over too much, the chairs may have to step in and ask you to wrap up as well. And we're going to try to get a bit of a balance, diversity of voices participating in this discussion. So on that note, we will start our first 15-minute question-comment period. Folks can just put your hands up, and we will, you know, try and point to and indicate who is going to be speaking.
I think, Ramenta, the first comment on anti-racism, and it's important. Of course, at some level,
that was, you know, impossible to contest, right? Like, racism's abhorrent. It's at the core of a lot of the development of capitalism in the United States, and we should oppose it. I think it's easy to say that, though, but then the harder question is, okay, so how do you actually win over the people who, to varying degrees, have been bought into segments of a kind of racist ideas? I think that a lot of this struggle, or most of it, can't be waged at just an ideological battle or front. So I would say we do actually need to find areas where we could organize with people and organize with them on that basis. But then what separates this from kind of a kind of version of social democracy that says that, you know, you're actually going to capitulate to racism and immigration is that when these issues come up, you don't you don't tolerate racist discourse or xenophobic discourses within your kind of tent. So I think that is key. You still need to rally people around and get them in the same place on the basis of kind of broad demands, shared demands. Then I think at that point, the ideological battle against racism is important within the group. I think it's slightly different than the idea of basically saying that, you know, people are enthralled to this kind of consciousness of racism and all they need is kind of an ideological battering ram. I think it's a bit more complex than that. I also think that, you know, a segment of Trump voters will vote for any future, and way down the road, socialist program, but potentially without changing many of their other views. I think, in other words, that if, let's say, someone is xenophobic and is worried about immigration, we can, in fact, make immigration their number three or their number four priority. And without capitulating to anti-immigrant rhetoric, we can, in fact, convince them that we're so much better on jobs, on security, on other issues they care about more, that they're going to vote for us. And they don't mind the fact that we're, you know, dirty communists who, you know, love immigrants. No, seriously. And I think on that basis, over time, we will actually be able to continue to erode their views of that. And we will push against the rhetoric that the house is already full and so on. So I think there is a difference in how we tackle and how we should think about of anti-racism, because often the way it's invoked is, I think, too vague and can't actually serve the purposes that we want it to serve, which is to eliminate racism in society. Slides and visuals, I agree. I'm not the most riveting speaker, particularly when I'm not properly prepared. Often it takes like an hour to write a really good paragraph, but it takes like just 2 minutes to write five paragraphs. And in writing, same as in speaking. But if you actually look at Jacobin, you know, we get the visuals, visuals down. All right, that's for Mika, not me though. But as far as organizing in small towns, I mean, this is something I'm very interested in too. I mean, there's a limit to what we could accomplish in small towns, partially because, you know, the American welfare state, the system is built to be so federated to make it on purpose really hard to push through left-wing demands. So it's often, you know, spun as like, oh, like little towns and cities can be laboratories of democracy. But in fact, it's not just that. It in fact limits our ability. Towns and cities can't deficit finance and do other things that the larger entities can do. So it makes it hard. There's an interesting book recently out I recommend you check out by Steve Early. And it covers some of the efforts in Richmond, California. And you know, so there are efforts. I think it's important. I think a lot of the same basic principles of left-wing organizing anywhere kind of applies to communities, smaller towns and villages, which is like, you just have to like start by asking people lots of questions, and then finding out about what they're concerned about, what their situation is, and whatnot. And you'd be able to craft a practical program and get, you know, other people on board and at least see where it goes. You know, obviously it's a lot harder than just saying it, but I mean, it often begins with kind of questions. Like, I haven't done organizing for quite a few years. I just kind of sit and yell at people on the internet now. But when I did, it often began with just me starting a conversation with people by asking them like 15 to 20 questions and maybe, you know, speaking for about, you know, one-fifth of the time. And one, if you're meeting someone new for the first time, if they're talking more than you in a conversation, like, they probably are having a good conversation. It's also, that's great date advice, too. So I provide it all. But, I, you know, so I think it matters, like, it is based on just talking to people, finding out what they're concerned about and whatnot. Now, On the question of how do we make socialism less of a dirty word, I think historically we did it by just being the best fighters for justice, the most consistent people defending democracy, the people willing to sacrifice the most. And I think over time, even if someone has certain ideological preconceptions of socialism, and this happens often like the labor movement, you know, they'll see that the organizers who identify as socialists are the ones, they're the latest, the ones doing it with no kind of no ulterior motive or agenda or whatnot, and that's how we win, credibility. I don't think we have to send out a PSA being like, you know, hey, we were against, you know, Stalin, you know, blah, 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 because it would just confuse people even more. I think we just have to do it by being open, calling yourself socialist, and then doing the work.
On the question about Kent, I don't know enough. But what I would say, I mean, I agree with a lot of the points that were made about that. But I would say I've heard, actually, it's interesting you asked about Kent. I know Socialist Alternative just started a branch in Kent. Is there anyone here who's part of the Kent Socialist Alternative branch? Raise your hand, and you are too, apparently. I would urge you, which you already are, I guess, to meet up with other members of Kent Socialist Alternative. And that's good, we're growing. I don't know everyone in Socialist Alternative. We need more of that. But there's no, one of the things I think that socialists have to contribute is the idea that there's not, is that we can figure these things out through collective discussion, working together, building organizations. And you guys have the answers. If you come together and discuss it and try things out versus what our society really pushes into this individualized, isolated thing, which one person's gonna help figure it out for us. That's one thing I would throw out there. In terms of the question that, the first question that was raised, was it Rebecca? About socialists and the anti-racist movement, I think that's a really important point, and I agree that there is that the danger you pointed to. I tried to point to it also, but maybe I wasn't clear enough. that I absolutely agree that part of the narrative of the 2016 election that we also have to push back against is that Clinton, the Democrats, you know, the solution going forward is we should talk less about race and gender and just talk about economic issues. And I agree, that's a wrong conclusion. And socialists should not be putting that forward. I do think, though, that it requires, on the other hand, in going into areas where working class people are starting from a conservative outlook, that it does make sense to start in organizing, not completely rejecting the framework of how Clinton and the Democratic Party operate, but how would socialists in those areas? You do need, I think it would be correct for socialists to start with trying to find where are points of agreement, where are things that we can work together on, whether it's on healthcare or raising the minimum wage, or expanding public education or public jobs programs, et cetera. Starting on those issues and winning people's ears. And within that, though, not in any way hiding our politics, not pandering. When racist ideas come up, take that up. And in the course of a struggle, I think one of the critical lessons of history, one of the critical things that socialists understand, is that people's ideas can change in struggle. And the most important thing is to find what are people prepared to move in a progressive direction and not struggle in a reactionary direction against, let's throw the immigrants out or something, but where there can be a struggle for an anti-corporate progressive direction that we can work together with people with all their confusion and over that break down that confusion and help them understand, have a better understanding of the dynamics of our society. The final thing just related to that, is the question that came up about if we're all, the danger of let's all work together against Trump, what does that mean about all the Russia stuff, trust the CIA? I think that points to some of the challenge that we face. On the one hand, absolutely, though that message, we do not want to subordinate ourselves to that liberal, patriotic, right-wing message that the Democratic Party is putting out to combat Trump. That is completely wrong. But I think also I agree with something Bhaskar said, that there's a danger that these new socialist forces have also a hostility to working together with other forces. So I agree, we need to be quite open and attacking that. That's not the message that socialists should be putting forward. We want to stress Medicare for all. We want to stress green jobs programs. We want to stress ending the racist mass incarceration state. We want to put those issues front and center, and that's not what the Democratic establishment is putting forward. And the idea that Russia interfered in our election, I think we want to ask the question, how often has the U.S. interfered in other countries' elections, right? But that being said, I think it would be self-defeating where we can have, if there's liberal Democrats who are holding who are prepared to do a town hall against Trump care, to say we want nothing to do with that. We want to fight to have a place at that town hall and put forward our politics, or if they refuse to let us have a place, be there and talking to the fresh people who are coming out. So I think we have to find that balance of engaging with the movement and fighting, being clear though that those ideas are not going to be helpful in building a movement against Trump, and we need to fight against them within our movement.
All right, so we're going to have another 10 minutes for questions and comments now.
Okay, yeah, so on the question of the Boeing trade union and these trade union struggles, I think it's an extremely vital point for us to see trade union struggles not just in the composition of the trade union movement, not just in kind of left-right terms, but in kind of bottom-up terms. So in other words, I think there's a tendency on large parts of the left to just be really encouraged whenever we find left-wing trade union leaders and think that it's our kind of duty to just take trade union leaders who are in the center or waffling and just ideologically convince them to kind of move left. And essentially what you end up with is a lot of people who day-to-day kind of like, not because of kind of their own moral and ethical kind of like, you know, worldview or whatever, but just because of the pressures and their structural position, end up just being another member of the trade union bureaucracy, but who at night kind of pray to the altar of socialism. And so it's a tough thing. So I think we need to really fight for and build democratic rank and file unionism, because the unions where the membership are the most involved, they're going to be the most militant. And if they're militant and the membership are involved, then it's going to be left wing. you know, if it's not, then as socialists, we're doing something wrong, but we have that kind of opening. It's, of course, hard to make this argument today when the union movement is in free fall, but I think we need to try to connect the resurgence of the trade union movement, rebuilding density, even in this kind of environment, which makes it very difficult, with building more democratic and more militant unions. We can't just try to pick off union staff or other people in kind of ones and twos. So I completely agree with that perspective. I think on that I might even out-trot, you know, the trots. So when it comes to the rhetoric of billionaire class, I mean, I think it was extremely important that the Sanders campaign actually named an enemy, right? Because otherwise it would just be kind of this warm and fuzzy thing. It'd be like John Edwards 2.0 or something like that. Not quite as creepy, but, you know, same thing. But I think the problem is, even though what Sanders is doing was creating antagonism, so he was saying, we want these things, and here's a billionaire class standing in our way. So that's good, because it created this class struggle there, right? But often when, especially internally, if we use words like billionaire, we're kind of mistaking a small group of people who are kind of the symptom with the broader structure. So the problem is exploitation, right? And the exploitation is the thing that make capitalists rich. Some of them are just as exploitative, they're just worse at it, right? And they only have like 10 grand at the bank, but they still have like, you know, 6 employees, and they treat them like crap, and they have no benefits and whatnot. You know, some of them have $1 billion. But I think the problem is kind of this social system and structure. So even if it's expedient, and even if it is actually good to use in kind of rhetoric talking about millionaires and billionaires, I think we should at least demand that millionaires be included. You know, I think in left settings and whatnot, it's much better, even not even to say the ruling class, something like that, but to use with precision kind of words like the capitalist class. As for the question about what to do in a high school, I mean, I think it's similar to what socialists should do anywhere, which is just kind of to try to, you know, talk with people, to try to discuss these issues, raise the level of class consciousness, you know, try to have a circle of people that you're discussing, and then maybe you're going out to some protests with and whatnot. And it sounds kind of modest, but I mean, I think that's the goal of socialists, to create these kind of circles and these groups of people. And as the conditions in the country change, as more and more people are going out there and protesting, you have a community of people right there to kind of, you know, mobilize with you and to themselves develop these ideas. I think it's not a ton different. Now, as far as the question of what DSA should be doing at kind of the local level, this is a very difficult question to sum up in like a minute, 30 seconds. I agree that DSA should be running candidates. I mean, I think a lot of this, though, based on the structure of DSA and its nature, just depends on what locals think they have the resources to do, think they have the candidates to do, and whatnot. I think it's key that there's kind of different types of endorsements, soft endorsements and hard endorsements. So a soft endorsement would be, let's say, endorsing Bernie Sanders or something, right? Which is something, of course, everyone would support, but DSA isn't a leading force behind it, and this person might not necessarily be a socialist. I'm actually more interested in running a small amount of kind of hard candidates that are explicitly socialists, that are going to foreground the fact that they're socialists and run on this kind of platform and program. But I think a lot of this depends, just because of the nature of DSA, just depends on what leaders at the local level, you know, kind of think is best. As far as the question of the ballot line, being independent of the Democratic Party and whatnot, I mean, this is a very, very big question I don't have time for, but I would say that if a candidate has its own, the question is more complicated east of the Mississippi, where we don't have nonpartisan local races, where almost every single race is partisan. But if a candidate has its own independent base of financing, if a candidate has its own ideology, if a candidate is connected to a broader socialist organization, And that candidate decides to run on the Democratic Party ballot line because they don't have the resources or ability to kind of contest and create their own ballot line, which is extremely difficult and onerous. How does that not constitute independent political action? You have your own basis of funding, you have your own ideology, you're connected with an organization. Your voting, presumably if you were elected, in part would be disciplined by that organization. How does that not constitute independent political action? Sometimes I think people fetishize the ballot line. The Democratic Party is more than a ballot line. It does actually have means to discipline and shape movements. It is the graveyard of social movements. I don't dispute any of this, but I think the short and medium term, in a lot of places, I do think we should be using the Democratic ballot line or even the Republican ballot line to run candidates as long as they're running not to just reform the Democratic Party and whatnot, but on an explicit open socialist basis with the connection with the social organization. I think that checks all the boxes of what constitutes independent political action in my view, and it wouldn't be a long-term measure. It wouldn't be to retake the Democratic Party. I think it's very important. Final point. I completely agree. There's a massive crisis of homelessness. It's probably most acute in New York. There's, if you count the shelter system and people sleeping out in the street, there's 60,000 people one night last year, which is just astronomical number. I think the reason why a lot of socialists don't foreground the homelessness and homeless in their analysis just relates to the idea of kind of social weight and power. And that's not a moral statement. It's not, like, everyone obviously has the same value and dignity to life. It just has to relate to their position in the production process. And the idea that you could radicalize 20 workers at the point of production and they have more power than all of us sitting here because of their ability to withdraw their labor and to disrupt production and capitalist accumulation. I mean, that's the reason why traditionally socialists would say that, you know, we need to organize this working class. We need to pay special attention to the most powerful parts of it, and we need to craft a program that includes all oppressed and exploited, you know, people. Which again isn't a moral judgment. It just you know, relates to this position. Finally, you know, I have my doubts about this socialist party, so I'll let Philip defend it. You know, I think in the long run, it's an important aspiration. I think, for one thing, these organizations have different structures. Like DSA is one organization, but there's different currents and people with different ideas and whatnot. It's still in formation. I think DSA would need to be, I would say, not more ideologically consistent, but at least have kind of a way internally of kind of mediating different currents and ideas and positions and having these debates before DSA was to be a part of a broader organization, particularly with organizations, you know, built broadly on democratic centralist, you know, lines. So all that's to say is, you know, not yet, but I'm just, you know, a vice chair is a very honorable position. It's like, people don't want me annoying them, so they just like put me on the letterhead, and it's a non-political position. Or, you know, it's political, but it's not. You know, I just show up to things. You know, I shake hands, kiss babies. You know, I don't have any say in these matters.
A lot of key and critical questions came up there at the end, and I'm not going to be able to deal with it in the time remaining. But quickly on Boeing. I think that poses a real question. What was raised about Boeing and the failure of the machinist leadership really poses important questions, that it's not just enough to build, and I think a challenge to DSA will face as it, now that it's a strong and important force, that's not just enough to have a general idea about socialism, but how will you apply that in the labor movement, in the working class? And in the labor movement, there is a real battle that is necessary against the pro-capitalist leadership of the labor movement, which a criticism I would have of DSA is that in the past, and DSA is a changing organization, it's growing, it has a lot of positive developments. In the past, my experience was there was a lot of people from that union officialdom who were part of DSA and participated in, while talking sometimes at rallies like this about socialism, basically acted in a very lockstep with that pro-capitalist leadership of the labor movement. But in Boeing, I think we here, I think Shama Swant gave quite an answer what was necessary at that time. Unlike the leadership of the labor movement, which was begging Washington State to give Boeing a $9 billion handout, that said, oh no, Boeing's threatening to pack up and leave, so we've got to give them whatever they want, demanded that Boeing workers accept their pensions be taken away, which is what the IAM international leadership did, and shoved that down their throats. I think a different approach based on class struggle outlook, which is what socialists would advocate in the labor movement, is that that was economic terrorism of Boeing. It reflects the realities of capitalism, that they have the ability, if you accept capitalism, to destroy communities, to destroy jobs, and that we need an alternative vision of society. It's possible to run Boeing, run society, on that without accepting their rule. And what points to that is we could have taken workers at Boeing, what we would have advocated is for workers at Boeing to take workplace action to shut down or slow down Boeing's production. It would take them time to move their production elsewhere. In the meantime, workers could have shut down their profits. But fundamentally, we have to be prepared with a vision, which I'm not sure is there yet, but at least we need a leadership that's going to be advocating and popularizing it, is that we could take Boeing into public ownership, that we don't need them, that they could be nationalized on a democratic basis, and they could be actually, on that basis, we could retool them to build socially useful production instead of more planes and war machines. And we could create many more jobs. We could protect the jobs at Boeing and create many more jobs on that basis. But of course, instead, the other logic meant giving them $9 billion in tax breaks that our Democratic Party state government did, hand over fist, eagerly, happily, and destroying the pensions of Boeing workers. I do think it's also linked to the other question that came up of how will we avoid a new left party failing to deliver like we've seen again and again internationally and historically. I think that's a critical question, and that also has to be part of the debate on the left, and also what I would urge, I think is something that DSA is going to have to discuss, and Socialist Alternative wants to be part of that discussion as well. It's not just enough if we look internationally and historically just to call ourselves socialists, but that the challenges are much greater if we actually become a serious force that actually is people are looking to change society. And I do think there is quite a painful history that we need to learn from of the past 100 years of the failure of the left and the socialist movement, which is far stronger than we are here in the United States, where they've been elected into power or elected into government and have failed and disappointed and have not fundamentally transformed society. And we've seen that recently with the experience of Syriza in Greece, which was elected on an anti-austerity basis and instead has actually become an instrument for austerity in Greece and is carrying out brutal austerity. And they, with the best of intentions, many of them, but the reality is it doesn't change the fact that austerity has not stopped under Syriza, and they've actually been used to enforce it under the IMF and the EU, et cetera. So I do think that poses questions that Socialist Alternative has thoughts about and that others in the movement will have to have thoughts, but there has to be a debate about that. Is in our view, a part, that's why our socialism is not just a question of nice ideas, but either a left force that is elected to power will have two options fundamentally in front of them. Either they will transform society and overthrow capitalism, or capitalism will transform them and make them into managers of the capitalist system. And we need any left force that is interested in standing up to the capitalist class has to have a program and policy and have an organized, conscious membership and prepare the majority of the working class to go into a struggle to transform society rather than trying to manage this existing society. And that does require to break that power of the corporations. Critical aspects of it is to take, it was raised earlier, I think, by Kaylin in the first session, a program of public ownership, of taking the big corporations into democratic public ownership, breaking their economic power, not just trying to regulate them, but also a question of mobilizing a powerful movement to deal with capitalist reaction, which I don't have time to get into. But I think that does require not just a broadly socialist movement, but building a coherent Marxist force that is going to systematically campaign for Marxist policies. It's learned from the history of previous movements. And that's what Socialist Alternative is dedicated to doing, working along with other forces on the left in a comradely and collaborative fashion, wherever we can agree to advance the movement, but also preserving and building a distinctly Marxist force around a clear program and policies that are trying to learn from different experiences, both the victories and defeats of the workers' movement and the socialist movement, so we're not condemned to keep repeating them. And that has to be done in a living way, not in a dogmatic, sectarian way, which unfortunately also plagues a lot of the socialist left, but also not in a light-minded, opportunist way, which also plagues a lot of the socialist left, of forgetting our history, forgetting lessons, not caring about politics. And that's the real struggle of the socialist movement, is to be very firm in our politics, but also very flexible in our tactics, be able to reach out and connect with new layers, to learn from the experience of the of new generations, of new struggle that breaks out. So I think this conference, just to wrap up, I think represents, I think, the very fruitful dynamic of those things, that we have a whole layer of new people here who are joining the socialist movement, who are looking to get active, who are looking to throw themselves into this struggle against this decaying, rotten system. I mean, we also, I think, have had a vibrant discussion of ideas, not a false unity, like Bhaskar said, about where just out of ignorance we all agree or we don't know anything, so we're all alike, but where there's been actually a serious debate about ideas and politics and in a constructive way, but in a serious way, and out of that we can learn, continue to discuss that while we work together in building a broader movement, but continue to take seriously those debates and discussions and fight also for the maximum political clarity. So I think this was a great start, and I'm really excited we can keep go forward, continuing to work together, and also building a stronger socialist and in my view, a Marxist and revolutionary socialist movement here in Seattle that can be, and also across the country and around the world. So thank you very, very, very much.